Good morning. As she said, I'm Elyse, and I currently work at Vivo. And at Vivo, one of the things that my team is responsible for is the website. And we have a lot of need for having great SEO. And so several years ago, we decided to build a universal app. Sometimes I call it isomorphic. And so I have a lot of experience building universal apps for SEO purposes. And as she said, I wrote a book about it. So if you're interested in learning more after this talk, then you can come talk to me later about the book. So what we're going to talk about today. We're going to go over what it is at a high level. I'm going to tell you about why you might want to build it, tell you about how you might go about building it, and what some of the added complexity that comes with a universal app is. And I may alternate between universal and isomorphic. It's pretty much synonyms for the same thing. So let's start by talking about what is it. To understand that, we need to talk about the current available web architectures. So first, we have server-side rendered applications. And a server-side rendered application, your user comes to the browser, gets directed to your web server, fetches some data, renders a page, and returns it to the browser. The downside of this is that you have to hit the server on every user interaction. So then we had single-page applications. And in a single-page application, your user comes to the browser, interacts with your API, and the UI is updated. This is pretty cool, but now I have to wait for your site to load when I first come to the browser. And it's also not very crawlable by bots like Google. So why don't we just do both of these things? So when we do both things, your user comes to the browser, gets directed to your web server, some data gets fetched, and now your page gets rendered. But importantly, we also send down the current state of the application as it was rendered on the server. This allows us to rehydrate your app in the browser and then enter single-page app flow. And then you get all the benefits of real-time user interactivity in the browser without having to hit your web server. But Google can still crawl you really well. Sharebots can crawl you really well. So why build it? I've already mentioned this, but let's say you have a site and you have a lot of cat videos. And these cat videos, you want them to show up first when people search. To do that, you need Google to be able to crawl your content. And so in a universal app, you're able to serve your content to Google quickly and completely every time, and also serve the needs of your users. There's also perceived performance. Often when we're building single-page applications, we have to use a lot of loading spinners. We have to wait to go fetch data after we load things in the browser. This is not a great experience. So when you first server render your website, people get to see the content immediately. There's still a little bit of a lag to actually interact with your site, but often the user won't notice if you do this right. And so you get the benefits of perceived performance. There's also developer benefits. You get to write everything in JavaScript. So that's cool because instead of switching context to go to my web server, maybe it was written in Rails or Java, now I just get to go and to my node server. And in fact, if you're setting this up correctly, like 90% of your code should be identical. So it should run the same in the node server as it does in the browser. So how do we go about building this? Well, the goal is we want to write code once and run it in two environments. So thankfully, pretty much every major web framework that exists today supports this. So this is great if you already have an app. Say you have an app that was written in Ember or Angular. As long as you're using the latest versions of these frameworks, you can go ahead and make it universal. React and Vue.js both have virtual DOM, which makes this whole process really efficient. And even like new things like Aurelia support this too. But if you just want to try it out, or you want to build a POC and sell your boss on this idea, then you can use one of these solutions, like Next or Next. Next is React, and Next is Vue.js. And they both provide an out-of-the-box isomorphic or universal solution where you just build your view and everything works. So let's take a moment and talk about the sort of magical part of this, why this is different than other things. So when you come on your server, you're going to fetch your data. Here we have an example. We have a user, and the user has a cart and some products. And we need to get this data to the browser to be able to use it when we build the UI in the browser. So we create a string from this data. And then in the browser, we deserialize that back into some kind of variable here called an initial state. And then we use that initial state to go ahead and start up our app. So this way, we create our app in the browser and have the exact same state and therefore the exact same HTML as we did on the server. What's cool about this is with like React and Vue.js, where you use this more like virtual DOM concept, you can avoid doing like any repaints in the browser. So it's really fast. So here's a visual example of this. So I've set a breakpoint right before my app hydrates. This is a React example. And on the left, you can see here's my UI. It already displaying to the user. And on the right, you can see where it will bootstrap. And in this example, once React updates, it'll be like, hey, there's no differences. That's cool. I'm not going to do anything. So let's talk about some of the added complexity here. Why is this maybe a little bit harder than what you do normally? So first, you have two environments. And these two environments don't work the same way. On the browser, you have a window and a document object, and Node doesn't know about those. It has different concepts, global environment variables, things like that. So you can do that. You can deal with this in a few ways. You can use something like Webpack to set environment flags so your browser and your server can both know which environment is which. That way, if say you have like a social widget which needs the window object, then you can not render it on the server. Make sure you always use a single source of truth for your user session info. So when you load off of the server, you should respect that state that comes down to the browser. Don't try to recalculate that state on that initial load. And then always make sure that your NPM packages are isomorphic or universal. So they need to work in both environments. Performance can also be a problem. This really depends on which framework you're using and how complicated your UI is. React 16 made huge improvements here for server renders, but you might run into problems regardless. So you can use caching strategies, render less items by only showing your user what they actually see above the fold, or explore technologies like streams. Finally, and I think this is the hardest part, is when you're testing, there are always two states, right? There's always a state where you load it from the server and you need to make sure that works. And there's always a state where you navigate to this feature or experience in the browser and you need to make sure that works. And I've seen people, very experienced people, come into this kind of app and still get confused by this until they internalize it. And so even though this has a lot of cool benefits in terms of SEO and in performance, I think you need to be aware that this can really be a challenge and a problem and something you're going to have to like give your team time to learn and understand before it'll be easy to work on something like this. So hopefully you now understand that universal architecture may add some complexity, but gives you clear benefits for SEO and performance. And hopefully you can use this information and decide whether you might want to apply this to real problems that you have. Thank you.